Hey guys, Scott from Aristocob.com here.
And Seth from Aristocob.com here.
Together, the three of us, we are Markwood Men's Breakfast Club. Welcome back. Welcome back, boy.
Thank you. Thank you. You too. Twice.
It's been a while. I mean, you may not have felt it, but it's been a while for us. The last time we got together and recorded was actually right after Christmas, before New Year's. So the videos with my dad, Seth's grandpa, ran for 3 weeks, and then we accidentally missed a week in there, too, just because I was traveling like crazy. Seth's availability has been bad. So we're happy to be back together with you, and welcome once again to Markwood Men's Breakfast Club. All right, I feel like I need to put my cup down. The cup's weighing heavy on my... But right there.
All right.
You can't see that, can you?
No, it's obscured completely by the...
Good, that microphone.
Microphone that's not doing anything. Except for obscuring a cup.
Yeah, so how you been?
Good. Been busy. It's getting into winter time, so at work, things have picked up a little bit. We get more frozen pipes, and water emergencies become more of an emergency and more difficult to get to, and everyone's been sick, so it's been short-staffed. So it's just been, that has even more led my work life to spill into my personal life, so.
Sure.
It's been awesome. Consumed. Yeah.
So this past week I was in California. The week before that we had snow in North Carolina, and it was bad. It shut things down. I had a couple people in town from Los Angeles for training, and they got trapped for 2 additional days that they weren't expecting to have to spend in the area because their flights kept getting canceled. So
yeah,
and I knew that was going to keep you guys busy.
Yeah, it did. It did. And, you know, our trucks, we've got, my guys drive big box trucks, practically U-Hauls.
They're bigger than vans.
Yeah, filled with stock. Yeah, they're not driving pickup trucks or anything. So, you know, we talk about them being warehouses on wheels because 90% of the jobs, they don't have to leave your home when they pull up.
Hmm.
And, but, as you can imagine, big trucks like that don't drive so great on ice. There were a couple of homes where we were able to approach their home from another street, where one street was just a straight downhill covered in sleet, and our guys were able to drive around. Some we just weren't able to get to at that time. We had our on-call emergency guy running in a pickup truck and using his own truck at his house as kind of his standby warehouse. So
as you might imagine, in North Carolina, not only do the municipalities have very little equipment to handle snow, because we just don't get it very often. But the drivers don't get the opportunity to get proficient driving in snow. So most things just shut down. And we've had schools shut down for 1/4 inch of snow. This time in this area, in southern High Point, there was, let's say, 3 to 5 inches. But as you went north through High Point and then on into Greensboro, and Winston-Salem, sit kind of side by side with High Point beneath them. They had 10 inches and above in some places on the northern side. And the way the school system works, the Guilford County, which includes Greensboro and High Point, if there is any street that they don't feel safe driving the buses down in the entire county, they shut the entire county schools down. Now that's weird to me. In Ohio, that would never have happened.
Yeah,
but here they're not going to risk it with the kiddos. I got to smoke something.
Yeah, there are over 130 schools in the county, and because it is a county-wide school system, if they have to shut down one school, they have to shut down the whole county. Whereas where we grew up, it was smaller areas, smaller regions, and so if one school is shut down, you're only shutting down 2 or 3 maybe,
right,
and not 130.
So in the morning when they're announcing the school delays and school closures, it runs and runs and runs and runs. We're here, it's Guilford County on a 1-hour delay.
Yeah.
All right, we're done.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to smoke. We're going to smoke something that I have avoided like the plague. This is a value-priced product that you'll find at head shops and drugstores.
And when you say we are smoking this,
you know that we're talking about the three of us.
Cool. Expect some in the mail, guys.
So here's the deal with this. This is actually manufactured by Sutliff. So there's hope. So what we're going to smoke, this is, they have, I don't know, about a half dozen, maybe more flavors, varieties of this. This happens to be a Cavendish, and it's chocolate. So it says all natural imported and domestic tobaccos. So imported and domestic, that pretty much says it all. Guaranteed extra mild without any bite. Created by master tobacco blenders by the traditional Cavendish method. We'll see how it goes.
So they take the tobacco they can't sell anywhere else, pour a little bit of Hershey's on it, and there you go.
I think that could be just it. You break the seal. Just done. All right. First off, the cam note. Try some of that. Who knows? Let's give it a try. So I'm going to smoke mine in a Country Gentleman Magna Cob. Magna Cob. Woo-hoo. It's a good thing that mic isn't working.
Yeah. Because it definitely isn't now.
You think that would be a problem?
Yeah. So, say what you will, think what you will.
I do.
All right. This chocolatey smelling tobacco reminds me of an old Bill Cosby bit where he talks about how he wanted to look like some of the tough kids in a school, and they were all chewing tobacco, and you know, he didn't know anything about that, so he got some Tootsie Rolls, ran them through a pencil sharpener, and put them in a tobacco tin and brought it to school. And boy, oh boy, did they think he was tough, especially when he started swallowing instead of spitting it out.
Wow. So, we have a couple things to talk with you about today. But the first one I want to mention to you is something completely frivolous. And that is these Mark Woodman Breakfast Club stickers. Now, we gave these away along with the cornaments at Christmas time. But I bought several of these. I purchased some on Zazzle. And was thinking about, if anybody's interested in this, how to get these to you. I don't want to make my wife's life any tougher than it is. And it's difficult for her to deal with selling pipes enough.
So you're just going to start putting one in every order from Aristocom?
No. If you're interested in one of these, send us... If you watch Zoom as a kid, send us a SASE. If you didn't watch Zoom, a self-addressed stamped envelope or envelope. Basically, what that means is you take two envelopes, you address one of them to yourself, and stick a stamp on it. Fold that up, stick it in another envelope, and address it to us. Put a stamp on it, send it. We then open up an envelope. Inside of that, we have an envelope addressed to you with a stamp on it. We will stick this in the mail back to you. Okay, that's how this is going to work. You're out two stamps and two envelopes, and you're going to get yourself an awesome Mark Woodman's Breakfast Club collectibles.
It's my 13th favorite YouTube Pipe Community
channel. Yes, it's all of our 13th favorite YouTube Pipe Community channel. And that's all I'm going to say about that. How many of them do I have? Not a lot, actually, but you know, if enough people want them, I'll have more made. I can order them from Zazzle. They're everywhere now.
How was your trip? You just got back.
I did.
From California?
Mm-hmm. I was in San Jose. Trip was good. I was traveling with one of our sales reps, as I do. I train our salespeople, product training and sales training. And then after they've been through the basic sales training course, I try to travel with our reps. And observe them, give them some tips, give their managers some feedback. So that's what I was doing out there, traveling with a rep. And but I got to go hang out with Chris Morgan at Morgan Pipes. So that was a lot of fun. I posted a video on my channel that it occurred to us after we had been together. I said on the video 4 hours. We had been together over 5 hours when it first dawned on us. You know what? We got to take some pictures. We got to shoot some video.
Yeah.
So we each shot a quick video for each of our channels and snapped some pictures for Instagram. But all in all, I was there with him and I think it's his fiance. Forgive me if I'm wrong. Isn't Paula your fiance, Chris? For about 6.5 hours. I really overstayed my welcome, but they brought in pizza.
That sounds like you.
They brought in pizza and chicken wings that were fantastic. Barbecue. Awesome. barbecue chicken wings, not chicken wings with barbecue on them, like they've been smoked, dry rub, really, really good chicken wings. And as Chris described it, Chicago-style thin crust pizza. So a thin crust, edge-to-edge topping, cut into pie shapes, right? So not like the Dayton style or St. Louis style, cut into squares. Very thin, but the bottom of it was interesting. The bottom of it, of the crust, was quite brown and a bit oily. So it's like they oil or butter the pan before they cook it. So the bottom of it got a nice, not exactly crisp fried, but it was a unique taste. It reminded me maybe a little of Donato's, for those of you who had Donato's pizza. But they got a white pizza, and they got a pizza with pepperoni, grilled onions, and pineapple. Now, that combination I normally wouldn't go for, but I gotta say, it was good. It was good.
Yeah.
We hung out on their veranda out of the back patio area, and sat and talked for quite a while, and then went to Chris's shop and hung out. And, you know, of course, I'm playing 20 questions. Where'd you get this? What's this? What does this do? You know, things on the wall. He's got so many knickknacks and tools and things. And every single thing that's there has earned its place. It's got a story, you know, some history to it. He's got some just awesome, awesome old tools that he has picked up over the years. And, of course, a lot of pipe-related things. But as a woodworker, hand planes and chisels and things that are really, really rare and in wonderful condition. Most of them are barn finds and things that people have given him over the years. Really, really fun experience.
That's awesome.
And of course, they're great people too. But I like their stuff.
Yeah, yeah. As is the way.
I'm really bad about that. Seth knows this about me. If you come to my house, I end up spending the entire time wanting to show you stuff.
Show you YouTube videos.
Yeah, show YouTube videos. But show you stuff. Oh, and check this out. I got this doing this. It's really bad.
Yeah.
I don't know why. I gravitate towards tangible objects that have stories to them. Like this lighter, how earlier this today when I was lighting the fire, I had to hold this lit for quite a while. And as I'm sticking it back in my pocket, my thumb is resting on that. So now I've got this patch that's got a bit of an owie, and I probably melted my pocket.
Well, that's why this format works well for you, because you don't have to ask them any questions.
Right.
Yeah, we just talk about stuff.
I'm gonna show you stuff.
Yeah.
Hey, speaking of that, I'm gonna show you something. I have been looking to organize some parts of my life that need organization, and that primarily is my suitcase. I got my normal travel stuff. I got my pipe bag, and I've got my shaving kit and stuff like that, but stuff seems to have grown and expanded, and I have so many cables, phone cable, iPad cable, cable for the faux pro, cables and charging cables for e-cigs, things like that.
You need to grid it.
Okay. And but I have more than just
cables. Or what's the thing that you're holding in your hand?
I have more than cables. You know, there's just all kinds of stuff that ends up being loose in my suitcase. I have a lot of pocket knives. You know, every time I take my pocket knife out at the last minute at the airport, I drop it into my luggage, and then I don't tend to take it out. So right now there's probably 8 pocket knives in my luggage. So I was looking for banker's bags. These are bags that we used to get to make night deposits with at the bank. Mm-hmm. And I found a supply on Amazon of a variety of colors. So you can buy them in any color that you like. So I went for yellow because I like yellow, but I may get some other colors so that I know when I reach into my luggage, you know, am I grabbing toiletries or am I grabbing e-cig supplies?
You should label them as well.
I could do that. I could just write on them with a Sharpie. But anyway, I thought I'd share that with you. I mean, maybe you have a solution for travel clutter, too. Look at that. Label that.
I don't need to. You'll be able to smell it. Have I not shown you the Grid-It?
You probably have. It's cool. I don't have one.
It's cool. I have one. I don't use it.
What is it?
But it's cool. Imagine just a sheet of cardboard.
Hold on, I'm imagining.
Okay.
I got it.
There yet? Got it.
Yep.
Okay, cool. Covered in fabric on both sides.
Yeah.
And like hard cardboard.
Oh, wait, mine's not.
Mine's not hard. Make it hard. Okay. And with a grid of elastic on it. So like a checkerboard pattern almost.
Yeah.
Of different sizes. So you've got strips that might be some this long, but they're interwoven, right? So imagine a checkerboard with a piece of elastic, and all you do is you just pull up a piece, shove your cord in, and it holds it tight to the board. But yeah, because they're different sizes, you can put your phone chargers, your cell phones, your cables, everything on this one piece of essentially like a clipboard size.
Okay.
And it's all there.
It's all visible.
It's all visible, all easy to grab. So instead of throwing everything into a bag and then having to rummage around, and in the process things get, you know, tangled up and undone.
I'll check that out.
Yeah. Also, the Max Expedition bags are great too. But that's a good simple
Well, I had used banker's bags, deposit bags, for years for things. I have a couple of them somewhere for my... In my clock business, I used to keep some things, some tools that I knew every single time I went into a customer's house, I would absolutely have to have my oil and my oiler and a few other things, gloves, things like that. And so I just kept them in the deposit bag.
Yeah.
And would carry my toolbox and things in only if it was necessary. And so that's what came to mind when I thought, I need to get some organization. I don't want to put in Ziploc baggies. I want something a little bit...
More robust,
and something that if I have to grab it and take it into a conference room or something, it's not all on display to everybody.
Right.
So.
Yeah, I really like this. I like the idea of having different colors for different things, too, because then you're not... Again, it keeps you from digging around and wasting time trying to find the bag that you're looking for. It's smart.
I have one of those thoughts every now and again.
Yeah.
So, we were talking earlier today, and I thought, let's let them in on this conversation, too. Maybe they'd like to react to this.
Is that the segue?
That's a segue.
Oh, that was good.
Thanks.
Yeah, so, earlier at lunch, pre-breakfast.
You blew it again, son.
Now you know. We're talking about... current events, and one of the things that has been big on Reddit the last couple of days is the Fine Brothers of Kids React, Elders React, YouTubers React, YouTube fame, have created quite a controversy. I honestly haven't even seen the original announcement.
Yeah, the original announcement came midweek.
Fine Brothers. Fine Brothers made an announcement.
They were happy to announce they're introducing this new concept that they're calling World React, I think it is, where they're encouraging other YouTube creators to create content that's similar to theirs, where they can get people together to react to things. And that they'll basically grant you a license to use their format and their name, and you can be a part of the React community. And I watched this, having not talked with Boy about it or anything, and my first thought was, I knew that they owned, I don't know if it's a
trademark.
Trademark, well, of course, to the React, but they've trademarked the style of program.
They have
some details about the program, how it's done. Anyway, I knew that they had done that, and my thought of all this was, okay, so they're tired of having to clamp down on people, so they're just going to go ahead and allow people to do this. And then Boy mentions.
Yeah, so they do currently own the trademark for the phrase, Kids React, Teens React, and Adults React, I believe. And so what that means at present is, let's say you... give your children some lemon and you film them chewing on the lemon, you can't title that YouTube video Kids React to Lemon Juice. That's a violation of their trademark. And somebody asked that question directly. The question on their Facebook page was, if I film some kids doing some reactions to Red Bull, can I call it Kids React to Red Bull? And their response from Fine Brothers Media Entertainment was, no, that's a violation of the trademark.
Unless you do it with our approval, right?
Right. Well, they didn't say that there, but yes, that would be the parameters. They said, you can show that, but it's a violation of the trademark to call it the kids reacting to it. Well, now they're trying to trademark the word react and the style of reaction videos. And they said, you know, the spin that they've put on it is that this is a positive thing for the community because it's going to enable them to license this style of video and create a worldwide community. And they talk about it in positive terms about how they liken it to American Idol spreading to British Idol, and how you know, that's a positive thing. You're getting a broader audience, and you can have the same show done in different places, and you know, they're spinning it very positively. But people have realized as they look into the trademark that they are putting a trademark on react videos. So any video where you're reacting to something, they could call trademark infringement. Any video, the other thing that they're claiming is the format of their videos. And they're claiming it in such a broad term that, you know, they could potentially make a case for any video having an introduction, any video having information on the bottom as you're presenting a reaction. So, like, there's the, like, pop-up videos from
they have a specific style.
The 90s.
And right. If you copy, they're going to say you've copied it.
Right. And
they're using such a fancy font, too, right?
Right. So they're using, like, a default font. So, you know, if you're caught using that, it could be trademark infringement. In addition to all of that, as I was reading about it a little bit between when we discussed and are filming now, as they continue to push out worldwide videos, and as they release their licensing to other countries and other video content types, it gives them even further power to claim trademarks on those things. So right now, they don't do a Firefighters React video series, but someone in Nigeria might decide to do that under the React Worldwide brand,
right?
And if they do that, then they can claim that copyright, and then they can prevent any firefighters from reacting to things. And as those videos continue to use that same content, that same formatting, then they build a stronger and stronger and stronger trademark case against anybody using any element of their format. On top of all of that, just in the last few days, they've already had, whether it's them, their parent company, they work for a parent company called, I just lost it.
Is it a parent company or is it a, what do they call that?
Conglomerative partnership.
Yeah.
They partner. There's another YouTube brand that I follow that is owned now. They sold themselves to that company. Film Screen is the name of the company, and so the it's gotten so bad that there's a channel that's criticizing the React announcement. He used footage from the React announcement, just like they use footage in all of their reaction videos,
right.
And the video was taken down.
What do you mean taken down?
It was taken down by YouTube.
YouTube shut it down.
It is now restricted in all. It says globally restricted. His channel is allowed no monetization.
And this is because he had so many subscribers, right?
He had 122 subscribers and the video had 8 views. Had 8 views on it when it was taken down.
Well, clearly their brand was driving all that traffic to his channel. So he was benefiting from their brand.
That's right. So now in, you know, he's created a follow-up video where he kind of talks about that. That one has over 4,000 views. And so he's actually now is driving content to him. So it's been interesting. It was trending topic on Reddit, on the front page of Reddit for a couple of days. Different threads have come in and out. What's another interesting thing is that the Fine Brothers have made this big claim that, you know, it's not for the sake of having any content taken away. It's really just for the protection of our content. And yet there are videos from 2 years ago of them encouraging their fans to go and...
make your own.
No, to go and not harass, but complain about an Ellen DeGeneres bit where she's asking kids to react to different things, claiming, you know, she stole this from us. So they're making these attacks on her 2 years ago. Then these other videos are being shut down by YouTube. And so their claims that, oh, you know, it's just for protection. It's not for
okay. So let's look. Anybody. Let's look at this the other direction, from the other side. You got guys that have worked very, very hard to create a brand. They didn't just create one show. They created multiple shows. They've got huge viewership. And they don't want someone else, maybe not just, you know, a you and a me, but another one of those big conglomerates to go and create their own show that is similar to theirs. And if they own the trademarks, then they certainly have every right to do what they're doing. Problem is, the internet is the Wild West. YouTube is just on the border of the Wild West. And especially when you're talking about wanting your audience to be involved in creating ideas, I mean, they're always asking for, what do you want to see next? What should elders react to next?
And well, that's part of their format. It's trademark. Right? So you're not allowed to ask viewers for ideas.
I have a story that I will share on our next video about this, because this whole trademark thing and patent thing is interesting. My visit with Chris Morgan, a bit of this, we were talking about patents and trademarks, and I find this all very fascinating, and it affects us all, even those of us who don't realize how much it affects us. And those things are done for a reason, but there's also those situations where you can argue that it's being abusive or overreaching and burdensome.
Yeah, I mean, it would be similar to saying that there can't be any buddy cop dramas, because I already have one, mm-hmm. or no talk shows where you have two hosts. Having two people talking about content, talking about stuff, you know, if that's something that's trademarkable, then we're probably in violation somewhere.
You know, what's interesting, and I have to go check this out, but it used to be you could not... Was it trademark or copyright? I want to say it's trademark. Anyway, you couldn't copyright the title of a book. So if somebody has a book called The Wizard of Oz, you can write a book called The Wizard of Oz. But there were a few exceptions where someone was able to argue in court that this is so closely associated with this content that it is now protected.
Right.
So, again, I'll have to do some research on this, and we'll talk about that some other time. Unfortunately, we can't talk about it next week, because next week takes place in just a few minutes.
No.
If you know what I mean.
Yeah, so one last interesting thing about this is that right now, at least with the React trademark, it's in the phase of the trademark process where it's open for public debate, opinion. And some of the other videos I've stumbled across on Reddit, one has been a lawyer offering his services pro bono to anyone that does make reaction videos, and how they might be negatively affected. Would this trademark go through? One of the things that's frustrating and a bit ironic about this is that their video series isn't the first reaction video series created on YouTube. You know, theirs didn't start until 2010, where the first ones were around 2007. So they're you know,
but they trademarked it.
They did.
There you go.
They did. So,
all right, we need to wrap this up. I think we're running long. We're gonna continue to talk on a similar topic next week. So be sure to join us. Give us your feedback below. Let us know what you think. What's your reaction? And visit aristocob.com. Oh, I swore I wouldn't do that anymore.
Thanks, guys. Bye.
Make it a great week.
No. I mean, do make it a great week, but we're done.
Yeah, I know. Make it a great week.
Bye, guys.